Department of Neurosurgery, Dr. Jayesh Sardara and his team for inviting me to give this lecture. I am, as you already know, Professor P.S. Ramani. Notwithstanding my age, what is my age anyway? Most of you know it also. Very soon, I will be completing 83 years and I will be going to 84th year. But I am still as active now as I was earlier, much earlier also. And I work as a senior consultant neurosurgeon at Lilavati Hospital and Research Center in Mumbai. And the title of my talk today is Evidence-Based Wisdom. Now let us have a few words on evidence-based medicine. All of you listening and talking since yesterday year know very well about evidence-based medicine, and all the presentation, all the papers, all the chapters that we write or talk has got evidence-based in it. Personally, I had popularized microlumbar discectomy. Microlumbar discectomy, as advocated by me, has stood the test of time, and there is enough evidence-based on long-term follow-up to say that it has stood the test of time, outcome is good, and it is in accordance with established guidelines. One can handle any pathology in the lumbar spine through this approach. This is the microscope I use. This is microlumbar discectomy. We are talking in the morning, in the sessions here, we talk a lot about facetectomy, how much you should remove, Somebody said 25, somebody said 45. This is drilling the medial part of the facet. And while we are doing this, my standard teaching to everyone who looks around is that it's a very, very difficult to say, because you are not exposed the lateral part of the facet, and therefore you don't know how much you are resecting really, but the guideline is that no sooner you find medial surface of the pericle, that is the end of your excision of the facet. You first drill it to make it thin, and then I use always Escula 45 degree forward, 2 millimeter, 1 millimeter, or 3 millimeter, depending on the need, to excise that part of the bone which is made very thin. Comments were made in the morning, which where you should start and where should come down, you know. You should always start at the top and come down towards the forearm and later on, and where you can decompress very well the traversing nerve root, you know. Here the nerve root, you are absolutely in close proximity, and therefore, rather than use the fan, this is I'm directly going into the foramen, it is better to use ultrasound revolving handle to decompress undercutting of the foramen here and decompress the nerve root. It does not damage at all the nerve root. You can go right outside from here, inside out. This is cutting the ligamentum in microlumbar discectomy. Either you don't remove the ligament, or at the most you can remove the lateral part, about 25% of the ligamentum flower. When it comes to the cutting the disc, you have to cut the annulus. Either it has nucleus has come out or is there, but it's not more than 20% that you remove. And under microscope, If the disc is sequestrated, it is shown there, you have to just excise it and decompress the nerve root. Sometimes in our country particularly, you can find large osteophytes growing from the vertebral bodies like this. They have to be excised because they cause foraminal stenosis. I have got a set of micro osteotomes made specially for me, which I use to osteotomize these osteophytes. The nerve root must be well protected, and once you are protected, there is absolutely no harm in using this osteophyte to excise this overhanging edge of the vertebra. This is the part you have to excise to decompress the nerve root very well. At times, you can do the same thing with high-speed drill. Very meticulously, your hand must be absolutely stable lest you damage the nerve root. As I was doing this, one behalf, as you know, and just now it was told you to have, I've been the president of WF in the Spine Committee for a long period of 8 years. I established a lot of programs at the WFNS, and we also now establish guidelines for the world to follow. We have established already guidelines for lumbar spine, cervical spine, and more recently one osteoporosis. I'm glad Dr. Parthivan is here as one of the panelists. He's very much involved into this program also. And all these guidelines are published in NeuroSpine. Pattern of guidelines, the pattern that we have followed, pattern that world follows. How do you decide on the guidelines? Reviewing the literature of the past 10 years or more, the articles reviewed are not necessarily without flaws. Conducting prospective randomized controlled trials are very, very expensive, one time, and secondly, they are time consuming. It takes a long time before you establish the results. Not possible to apply for spinal surgery with most problems having an element of urgency. On this background, I was intrigued very recently, May 21, just a couple of months back, in Neurosurgery, there is an article, Quality of Literature Searches, published in leading neurosurgical journals, and it is an article on review of the reviews they have done. What a fantastic idea. And their conclusions are that there is mounting evidence that the search strategies upon which systematic reviews are based, including ourselves, they frequently contain errors. The study demonstrates that the search strategies that we are using now in spinal surgery or neurosurgical system requires improvement. That is where we stand now. So, evidence-based medicine in spinal surgery. Now, let us talk about the characters like conscious, explicit, judicious, and reasonable use of modern best evidence in making decisions about the care of individual patients. The question is, how rational it is? So, what do you do? Do you follow evidence-based medicine or you follow evidence-based wisdom. Optimal treatment for a cost containment tool that you have to answer very honestly to yourself first and then to the patient. Dilemma, which is more important? A successfully treated patient or religiously following PCOT, that is patient intervention, comparison, outcome and time. How safe is the surgeon if the guidelines are not adhered to? And what if a surgeon can give better results working away from the established guidelines? So the role of wisdom comes in. First of all, can we afford RCT in spinal surgery? We have to very honestly answer this question. If not, how do we get the evidence? Is it ethical, valid to form control groups in spinal surgical issues which are relatively urgent? Which is more important? Clinical and surgical wisdom, or you follow guidelines, mathematical? This is Sir William Hulsler. Even today we follow him, everybody knows him. According to him, the good physician treats the disease. The great physician treats the patient who has the disease. Medicine is a science of uncertainty and the art of probability. And very important is the greater the ignorance, greater the dogmatism. Sanya Guruji, Maharashtrians all know him. Whatever medical knowledge we possess, whatever surgical art we acquire is meant to make life very beautiful for the patient. And you know Viktor Frankl very well, all of you. He said the spinal surgery should be practiced without falling prey to outside liver. Charles Darwin, many of you know him, is an Englishman, naturalist, geologist and biologist, best known for his thought on evolution of humans. Average intelligence, he was not very intelligent, and he was in fact dropped out from the medical school. But he was a very successful man with his thoughts. And he said the survival of the fittest is through natural selection. Evidence-based wisdom, and this is Sternberg's theory of human intelligence. Ability to achieve success in life according to one's personal standards within one's socio-cultural context. It includes analytical, practical, and creative abilities. Personal standards like IQ and education, he need not be a genius with 194 IQ. He can just be average with only 100 IQ, but he must be inquisitive, analytical, creative, rational, and practical. Arthur Conan Doyle, no, who does not know Arthur Conan Doyle? He was a genius, you know. He was medical doctor, but he was as famous as a writer and created rational, intuitive, with perfect reasoning. And yet, fiction, it was a Sherlock Holmes, was a fiction. He said he never guessed. If we guess, it is destructive to logical thinking, logical faculty. Through Sherlock Holmes, he correctly pointed out Jack the Ripper in 1889 in London. He was a murderer. He had murdered six people, but the police could not find him. He pointed out through his rational reasoning. Richard Feynman, another genius. He was very average at school, but passionate about physics, became a physicist and was awarded Nobel Prize for his work on quantum electrodynamics in 1965. You all know it very well that in 1986, American space shuttle Challenger exploded in the sky. Feynman, he was not connected with the space shuttle, but he had, just like Arthur Conan Doyle, he made a tenacious inquiry and he exposed the engineer inside their team. It was his mistake which has caused the shuttle to explode. Was it deliberate? No. Was he not intelligent enough? No, he was. But he was overconfident, inflated ego, and dogmatism. I know everything. He had overlooked this mistake. This is known as intellectual trap. People sometimes fall into the intellectual trap and create mistakes, sometimes serious, such as this. In India, of course, you know, who does not know Nobel laureate Raman? One day he wanted to open an office in Bangalore. Somewhere he wanted four scientists to work with him. He asked for interviews and they were paid traveling expenses. But Chandrasekhar did not qualify. Before going home, he found that he was left with 6 rupees extra from the traveling allowance. He went straight to the office, but by then it was closed. He did not know what to do with that 6 rupees. But he knew that Raman in the morning goes for a walk. So next day morning, he waited there in the garden. And when Raman came, he approached him and told him everything. Raman thought for a while and called him to his office. He said, "You come and see me in the office at 11 o'clock. And when he came, he said, "You failed in the interview on your merit. But today, you have been selected for your honesty." So one more post was created. Instead of 4, he appointed 5. He worked with him, Chandrasekhar, for a few years, then moved to America. He became a scientist, and in 1984, he was awarded Nobel Prize at a time when other 4 boys were nowhere. Curiosity is the key of wisdom. Curiosity is common with high achievers, even with average intelligence. As a doctor, now I know that curiosity activates neurotransmitter dopamine in the prefrontal cortex. It also transmits the information to hippocampus, causing long-term storage memory. You all know this. No? So in general intelligence, which includes education, curiosity, and consciousness, are the pillars of academic success. General intelligence, it includes, as I said, education, analysis, curiosity, and consciousness. Lessons to the spinal surgeons: seek new information all the time. Look out for new things or experiences. Embrace difficult and complicated events rather than just following routine things. Lessons to the spinal surgeon: explore your own problems. Many times, after all, spinal surgeons are there human beings. They have what? Personal problem, personality problem. You must explore them and sort them out. Explore different perspectives. Imagine alternate outcome. Identify erroneous arguments. Intellectual humility, very important, can make us see in the bias blind spot. Very important. Don't be arrogant. Form more rational options. Avoid misinformation. Learn effectively and work more productively. World healthcare system has progressed significantly with technological boom. But World Economic Forum has identified two things which are detrimental to a rapid and meaningful growth. Number one, increasing polarization of people. When I was a resident, oh my God, we work all together in unison. Today, even residents are not looking at each other. That is called polarization. Spread of misinformation is digital wildfire. It is everywhere, everywhere. And you must be very cautious. When somebody tells you something, when you read something, is it true or is it a misinformation? Dedicated medical profession of the past, when I was a resident at Nair Hospital in medical school, I was taught among other teachers by one physician, clinical, called Dr. D.D. Bang, who purely by percussion and auscultation could draw with pencil a tuberculous cavity in the chest. Today, the world has changed and knowledge is at the doorstep through net. Even patients today know about their illness by browsing through Google. So what is the doctor's responsibility today? Spare a few moments to listen to the patient intently. Most of the times, that conversation conveys correct impression of diagnosis, pathology, and expected management. Examine the patient very carefully. If you examine the patient very carefully, and this is the time, everyone should make a working diagnosis. Many times with dedicated doctors, it almost proves to be correct. If that is correct, then do only those investigations which are absolutely necessary. Prognosis, never speak in a very negative language to the patient. Always speak with hope, optimism, and empathy. You never know. Today, we all know it is general knowledge that many diseases. When I was a student resident, we learned we did not know anything. They are decoded by the genes today. Example, burning examples is Alzheimer's disease and neurofibromatosis. Doctor should be conversant, should talk to the patient. They should be observant. Do not contradict the patient. Rational thinking, rational medicine, analyze the misconceptions. A wise doctor strives to know more, keeps good records, learns from mistakes. Because wisdom comes from knowledge, and knowledge comes from experience, and experience comes from mistakes. If you understand this, then it is you are wise. So, evidence-based medicine, it has been observed just now that research strategy used in neurosurgery team requires improvement. As an evidence-based wisdom, general intelligence includes education, curiosity, analysis, creativity, and consciousness. Today's necessity is that practice spinal surgery, combining evidence-based medicine and evidence-based wisdom. Most important, when you approach to the patient, it is you are one-to-one with the patient. Then your evidence-based medicine does not become much helpful to you then. Neurospinal surgery is a profession that challenges the doctor to be all the best. We never seem to reach the end of our career while treating patients and start living with them. The wisdom we gain teaches us the meaning of life.